When I was like 9, maybe, I was living in a house down on G Street here in town in Indianola, and I was off the bus, and for some weird reason, we got into a fight, and he wanted to fight me. Yeah, so we almost boxed that day, and then I just came over the next day, and we hung out, and we were just like best friends ever since. I have no clue why. Scott Sullivan. I moved to Indianola when I was about 7.
I'm Robin Morse. James was my boy.
James was really smart, loved to debate, really argumentative.
Our house was always loaded with children, neighborhood children, riding their, our front yard was always full with bikes and kids playing.
James was friends with everyone. There's like, I don't think there's like one person that wasn't friends with him. He was one of those guys that you're just like, he's your friend. Yeah, he was a good guy.
Daniel lived a half a block down from us. James met Daniel because they rode the bus together. They were just friends and, you know, somebody to play with, somebody to hang out with.
Dan called and told us that we should come over and hang out with him. I mean, I didn't think anything of it. He told me his dad wasn't home. That's all we knew, that he wasn't around. We assumed he'd eventually come home.
James and Scott left without my permission, and they went over to Daniel's.
From the second that we got there, there was, I mean, an unloaded gun already out when we got there. I mean, it was something we probably just should have seen and then walked away from, but we didn't. We were hanging out there for a while watching a movie, and he kept making like references towards his gun and like kept picking it up and touching it while we were talking. I mean, growing up in Iowa, people have guns all over the place. They hunt, they talk about guns 24/7 here. I didn't think anything of it. It was just a gun sitting there. And we started talking about like religious and political views and stuff like that. Dan was the one who brought it up, like about him being a Christian. And of course, you know, James being very argumentative that he was, argued about how Christianity was wrong and there's no God. And Dan was getting angry. He was getting very angry.
James had came to me and told me Dan had issues, that he was angry with his father. His father had kicked him out of the house, and he was just walking around town. And at one point, he had said that Daniel had told him he wished his father were dead. And James is like, what do I do? And me being a mom, I just told him he needed to be his friend.
Dan thought it was more than an argument. He thought it was him, somebody trying to tell him that his life is wrong. He argued and argued and argued, and Dan started to pick up the gun and point it at him. He wouldn't even say anything. He just dry fire. He just like pulled the trigger. There was nothing in it. We knew there was nothing in it, because every single time he did it, we would panic. Like, whoa, you need to, like, that's not something you play with. You like put that down, you know? That's not, you grow up here knowing you don't point a gun at another person. And he picked it up and dry fired like a few times. I mean, we told him not to, we told him to stop, we told him to put it down, you know, like it's not okay. I was sitting on the couch and James was sitting next to me, and he finally was just like, okay, we're done with this conversation. And so Dan was fairly angry about that. I remember because he walked into the kitchen, he walked back out, sat on the chair, and I was just watching the TV, and out of the corner of my eye, I could tell he was doing something. I didn't know what it was, but he picked up the gun and he pulled the trigger and it fired. And he shot my best friend. It was really loud, like to the point where it almost, I think it like knocked me out or something, because I woke up, my ears were ringing horribly. I remember like being really confused about what happened, looking at my legs, and there was blood all over my legs. It was like right about here in his chest. We found where it was and we tried to stop the bleeding.
It was a little after 6 a.m. and my daughter woke me up and told me that there was a police officer at her door.
It was bad because when we were trying to like stop the bleeding from happening, he hadn't died yet. And so we were trying to like keep him awake.
I got up and I went out to the living room. The boys weren't there and I thought, oh no. My heart kind of sunk and Officer Keller asked if he could come in, and he told me he had some really disturbing news.
He knew, he knew that he had been like hurt in some way. I don't think he knew he'd been shot, but he could tell, and we were like yelling his name, trying to keep him awake. There was nothing I could do.
He proceeded to tell me that there had been a situation with James, and James was shot and killed. I remember asking him, not my son, are you sure it was my son? And Officer Keller said, yeah, it's your son. And he told me that the other boys had identified that it was James.
I've never had to tell anyone that their family member's been deceased from a homicide. Lots of suicides, lots of accidents, but never from a homicide.
I just remember, you know, my mom and dad, wanting my mom and dad to take me over there because I wanted to go in and hold my son. And I remember going over there, but they wouldn't let me in.
Daniel was in shock, I would say, not showing emotions. Scott was the opposite of that. He was crying, visibly upset.
County 911.
Oh my God, my friend has just accidentally been shot.
Okay, what was he shot with?
A shotgun.
How old is he?
He's 16.
Is he breathing?
I don't think so. Oh my God.
My children's father died when they were 3 and 4. And the moment James was shot, I always wonder, did he feel it? Was it painful? Was his father there to help him? I always wonder what he went through, if he suffered. I think about that every day.
The gun was hidden in the closet. What does that mean? You know, kid knew where the gun was and it was not locked up.
I feel Daniel's father is just as guilty as Daniel. He wasn't a parent. Any parent that's gonna go away to be with their boyfriend or girlfriend and leave your child at home, knowing your child has issues.
You didn't have to unlock anything. You didn't have to break a lock. You didn't have to find the combination to a safe anywhere. It was in the closet. We knew where it was.
If you're going to be a gun owner, I think you need to be responsible. And it's your responsibility to make sure that that gun is locked away.
James's death is tragic on a lot of different levels. Good kid by all accounts. It was access to a firearm. That's why James is dead. It was access to a firearm. I'm gonna say it again. It was access to a firearm. That it was unnecessary.
Well, when he was dry firing, he would really hold it like he was just like pointing it, you know. But when he shot it, he was like aiming, which is like, I don't understand. Like, I mean, I'd seen people shoot at targets before, and that's the same way he was holding the gun. I don't know why he'd do that. When I walk in the hallways at school, I have headphones because I don't want to hear someone drop a book on the ground and make a loud noise next to me, or because that'll set me off, or it's just something you have to deal with every single day of your life. This doesn't go away.
I have nightmares occasionally. I have nightmares that my son cries. Sometimes I jump out of bed and try to run out the door, and then it hits you, reality hits you.
I have nightmares revolved around that night. Either that or they're just dark. I don't want to sleep. It sucks falling asleep and dealing with that every night. Maybe we could have prevented it by seeing a gun and knowing that it shouldn't be out. When he first started dry firing, to realize that we probably should have left. You know, you don't point a gun at a person. I mean, there's so many red flags that night, and we just ignored them. We were kids that thought, you know, this would never happen to us.
We were taking our first family picture. Yeah, there's one of them in there. She was okay. We went to take the second family picture. She cried the whole time. And then it's a picture in there with her brother, and she's staring at it like real fearful. I don't know what it was about, but he was holding her hand. Even though she was as cute as she was and, you know, taking pictures, we wanted to take pictures, she'd hide her face. My name is Cheryl L. Duncan. I moved to Houston August the 30th, 1986. That's when we got married. She procrastinated a little bit, you know, doing her homework and things like that, but she was real smart. She liked art. She didn't really like math, but she loved English and history.
I was always kind of envious of that because I always had to work hard in school and, you know, study, but it just kind of came natural to her. She'd just, you know, look over some stuff, you know, over the night before and then take the test and get an A.
She was always the tallest one, biggest one, and so she'd always want to sit up front and they'd always want her to sit in the back. She didn't like that too much.
Back and forth when you're younger, bickering, you know, kind of like a little jealousy, just, you know, why are you here? You know, just stuff like that. But once she got older, we started to get close and we developed we just decided we were best friends, you know?
Over in that way is, I believe, where it occurred, where Ashley committed suicide. She shot herself in the mouth.
I wasn't aware of the suicidal thoughts, but as far as depression, I was aware of that, you know, while I was in college. That's when she was in high school. It seemed like whenever time I left, that's when she went into depression.
One of the therapists said, there's something there. She's just not sharing everything. The first time she went, I think she really was open with a lot of things that she went through. And then as we went, it get to the place where I think it was just, you say what you can so you can get out. You're gonna hurt yourself, you're gonna do this, you're gonna go to the doctor, you're gonna go to your therapist. Her dad had told me that she seemed to be a little more just depressed and crying, and she told me she was okay. Her father kept his guns for being a policeman in the trunk of his car. He took just the key to the car off his key ring that he had laid down and went to the trunk and got the gun out. And when he got back home, he smelt some smoke. And then he realized what he smelt in the house was smoke from a gun. She had tested the gun to try it out. And she went up to the bayou. And as she was walking, that's when she texted me. And I've took my dad's gun. I'm tired. I'm sorry. I can't do this anymore. I love you. Bye.
And Leah Allen, she was one of my closest friends, almost like a little sister. So I was working at my aunt's office, and I was following her on Twitter. She would normally smoke in the morning, so she would sit in the same spot and be right outside of her house or like right in that front yard area. And she would kind of like take a picture. So she was like taking a picture of the gun at this point in time. And I was sitting at the office and I stopped and I was like, what the hell was this?
Just earlier that day, I was talking to one of my friends about what was going on with me and my sister, how we're not talking, and she was, you know, just telling me like, it's gonna be okay, you know, just reach out to her later on, you know, she's gonna be fine. I got a phone call from my other friend saying that, can you come out to the yard? I need to speak to you. So I came over there and she looked very hurt and gave me the phone. And she told me that my sister committed suicide.
He was like, it's about Ashley. I can't tell you on the phone right now. Just go to my house. It's like, Anthony, don't do this to me right now, because I know I just seen the picture of the gun. And so that's the first thing that popped in my mind. I pull up to their house and I saw a police car in their driveway. And I fell out, like I just lost it completely. And I just laid there like in the grass until her mom came out. And she told me, I was like, where is Ashley? She's like, it's okay, it's okay. And I was like, no, stop telling me it's okay. Like, where is Ashley? Like, where is Ashley? She's like, no, it's okay, really. Like, it's okay, just come in the house. But I already knew.
My name is Sharon Brenner. I was a social worker at Bel Air High School. I met Ashley because her volleyball coach was concerned about her being sort of sad and maybe somewhat depressed. And in my capacity as a social worker, she asked me to visit when the school was tough. It's a very, very competitive high school, wonderful high school. And there's a lot of academic pressures, not only on Ashley, but on all kids today.
Ashley used to write a lot in books and journals, and I would find them. Then I noticed she stopped doing that. And on one of her comments, she wrote, Tumblr knows her better than the parents.
I know she wasn't happy, but to everyone else, she looked that way.
To her friends, she was just, you know, she was loving, she was happy. She was the person that they went to for advice or for encouragement or motivation. To us, she was angry and upset. A lot of just emotions that she had towards, you know, mostly like my father. And I guess towards me and my mom. After the fact, that's when I did my research and I just looked online. I was just like, wow, all this stuff was going on. And I really had no idea. I think she used social media as an outlet because nobody could judge her. Nobody could tell her she was wrong. It's basically she was talking to like a glass mirror.
We're trying to make sure you're okay, but if you reject it and if you're not able to address those problems with someone, like what else can we do?
I always ask kids when they come to my office, I ask them to give me 3 wishes. As part of an initial interview. And one day they asked me, what would you wish for? And I said, I would wish that the social media was not so available to people.
When I looked on there after everything happened, I saw she had a lot of photos on there that described how she was feeling. I was kind of shocked and amazed, like, what made you to feel like you couldn't talk to somebody that you had to put it on Tumblr and Twitter so everybody could see you? There was a letter on her Tumblr saying that she felt like she was walking dead. She was just popping pills and just smoking weed so much that so she can just not feel anymore. She felt like her purpose on this world was no more. The person that she was in love with, that she was with, didn't want to be with her anymore.
There's a sense that the people don't connect anymore the way we used to. You don't, even when you would pick up a phone, you don't hear people's voices anymore. Everybody's texting. I think we're losing a connection that's very important. And I think in terms of mental health, you need those connections. You know, if Ashley had been talking to a friend or talked to a parent or talked to her therapist, anybody in the school, and we knew that other side, then maybe we could have prevented this from happening.
Last time she posted on her Instagram, she said, "I finally got a gun." People were liking the picture. And I mean, that really caught me a alarm that when nobody even called her or anything, or why would you even like the picture in the first place? I didn't see any comments of like, what's going on? The last words she said to me were, she said, you're dead to me.
To it may concern, I've taken all I can take. I'm tired of feeling as if I'm not good enough. I failed myself. I tried all the medicine I can take. It's not working. I'm in a deep depression. I'm sorry for everything. I feel as if I'm working on hell's boundaries. Honestly, I've been thinking about killing myself since third grade. Living a life like mine isn't a life worth living. To my understanding, I'm just not good enough, and I give up when the going gets hard. I love those who are close to me. Goodbye. Don't worry about me. I was born a screw up. Just let me die and be forgotten. With love, Ashes Yadine Duncan.
So James is here and Natalie is there. And these kind of have shifted around a little bit, but this is how we roll here. This, we all sleep in the same bedroom. And I'm not gonna do anything to discourage it, because they can stay here as long as they want.
My name is Mark Barton.
On the morning of December 14th, 2012, James and I were walking down the driveway. It was dark and cold, and I hear little footsteps behind us. And it's little Daniel running down the driveway in just his pajamas. It was like, you know, I don't know, 19 degrees. And he had put flip-flops on his feet. I'm like, what are you doing up? And he said, I wanted to come to the bus with James and kiss him and hug him and tell him I love him. And it was the first time that ever happened. So we did. We walked James to the bus together, and he had to wrap his little arms around him and kiss him and tell him he loved him. So then we got back to the house. I said, you know, it's still dark. It's very early. You can go back to the bed. You have quite a bit of time. And he said, no, Daddy, this gives us more time for cuddling. So we did. We got on that couch there. And I turned the Christmas tree lights on. So the tree was right here. And we were laying on the sofa here. And then Daniel noticed the sunrise coming through that window there. And he said, look at how pretty the sunrise is. And then he said, oh, and you can see the reflection of the Christmas tree lights in the window, with the sunrise behind it. And I was like, yeah, really? Like, who notices that? Let alone a 7-year-old. And I wish I had taken a picture of little Daniel right there on the couch. Outside of the unusual circumstances that took place that morning, those were just wonderful, delightful things that took place that morning. It was a great morning. And I just walked back up the driveway, looking at the beautiful morning, and, you know, happy that it was Friday and we were gonna have our Friday night pizza. We had looked at Newtown a long time ago, and we thought it was either too far or too expensive, but we were able to luck into a good deal in a neighborhood. But the primary incentive for us to move to Newtown was the school system. I got an email message, I got a phone call that there had been a lockdown in the district. And that stuff happens from time to time. You know, it's almost always just, you know, nothing. And then the calls and the emails started getting, you know, more specific and more detailed. That in fact there was Newtown, there was an incident at Sandy Hook School, and then there was a mention of a shooting. And then of course then it's just like fly out the door. and the news was reporting something about an incident at Sandy Hook High School. There is no Sandy Hook High School. It's Newtown High School. It's Sandy Hook Elementary School. So I figured maybe there's something at the high school. Anyway, as I approached the elementary school, which is just a little schoolhouse down a quiet country lane, to arrive on this surreal scene that looked like not even like a movie set. I mean, just more emergency vehicles and personnel than I'd ever seen in one place ever. And so they're collecting all the kids, and parents are collecting their kids, and I'm looking around for Daniel's class, and nobody really knows what's going on. And then there's a word that there was maybe a shooting in the school, that maybe the principal had been shot. And I started thinking, how am I going to explain this to Daniel? This is going to be very, you know, traumatizing if there was an actual shooting inside the school. You know, I started gearing up for having that conversation. They were assembling all the kids. They were getting everybody out of the school, and the parents could meet their kids and pick them up. You know, somewhat chaotic, with the parents who hadn't been reunited with their children yet, kind of desperately looking for their kids. I think one of the state troopers actually said, you know, we can confirm that, you know, 20 children are dead.
Gary Wheeler. I've lived in Newtown for 59 years, driving school bus here for 46 years. A neighbor of the Bardens was at the bus stop and took them off and told me how, you know, they couldn't find Daniel, and Natalie and James were all upset because they didn't see Daniel at the bus stop.
Our trooper was Dennis Kane, and he introduced himself to us and said, I'm here to help you do whatever you need to do. And he said, I think we should probably go home. I remember just sitting in the trooper car, you know, looking out the window at the, it was almost, I guess it was getting into the afternoon, because I think it was getting, you know, kind of a darker sky. And I remember looking at the trees going by and just unable to process what was happening. I just couldn't get my head wrapped around it. And I looked to my left, and he was just, you know, driving down the road with his eyes fixed on the road and tears coming down his cheeks. I'm thinking, oh my God.
Try to assure him that, you know, Daniel's probably fine and everything. And then as I drove up the hill here, I saw Jackie and Mark in the police car, and I knew. And well,
yeah.
I knew it was. That was what it was.
My name is Karen Labanca. I have a daughter, Anna Rose, who's 12, and a daughter, Marguerite Jane, who's 10. She goes by Maggie. When the Bardens moved in, Daniel was 2 and Maggie was 3, and they became inseparable. Our houses are, you know, physically beside each other. And our house looks down on the Bardens' house. You know, the elevation change, you look down into their house. And Maggie's extremely nearsighted. And I guess she had taken off her glasses and was doing work at her desk. And then all of a sudden, you know, gunfire and screaming erupts on the PA, and her class in the 3rd grade was around the back side of the building. And I think that they suddenly was yelling of lockdown and get down, and she didn't have a chance to grab her glasses, so she couldn't see anything happening. They had to leave all their backpacks in the school and all their belongings, you know what I mean? They literally just fled with what they had on them. So the whole weekend she couldn't see. She told me that weekend she was so upset, and because she couldn't see his house and she couldn't see his bedroom. And she would just stand at her window trying to see his room. Just sucks.
I've had this very close, intimate relationship with all of my children from their birth, you know, all the way through. And I just felt that there was this very important and significant part of Daniel's little life that I didn't know about. And I guess I was hoping for confirmation that it was quick. Against the advice of almost everybody else, like, just don't go there, I can't help it. It just kind of seeps in, especially when I'm, you know, in a quiet moment, laying in bed. It'll keep me up, and I kind of, I'm in that scene. I'm replaying it, and the horror of it, and the terror of it, and I just can't, I'm sure that it's gonna haunt me for the rest of my life.
6 months before the shooting, there was, in New York City, a guy followed his ex-employer to work and then shot him outside the Empire State Building. And my, at the time, 10-year-old daughter, Anna, was listening, said, Mom, you know, would that ever happen here? Would someone, you know, shoot someone we know here in Newtown? And I said, no, not in Sandy Hook. We live in such a small community. It's so great here. We have lots of great friends and family nearby, and nothing like that's going to happen here. We're so safe. And then the shooting happened, and Anna came at me, and she said, you lied. You were wrong. It happened here.
In the home of the shooter, there was this disconnect between the mom and the son, and the mom was trying to establish those connections and probably could have made different choices than to, you know, exposing them to, you know, shooting firearms, but that in itself does not lead to a mass murder. And but this didn't just happen overnight or in a week. You know, this has been probably a lifetime of a continuum that led to this. We'll never know for sure, but there had to have been multiple markers, multiple opportunities to intervene. I think our responsibility of being parents transcends the responsibility of our own children, but to kind of look out after our neighbors and our neighbors' kids as well. Sometimes a voice from away will notice something that is maybe too close inside the family to notice.